for me, the idea of sustainability was first taught to me when I met a group of organic bean farmers from the state of Michigan. They're in the Thumb area, and this was back in 1978 when there was no such thing as a national organic rule or law, and there was really even no such thing as certification. But I went to tour these farms, and I remember the feeling I had the first time I stepped on an organic farm. I stepped onto their fields, but what really happened was I stepped into their fields because their soil was so springy that it covered my shoes with dirt. And then I saw butterflies fluttering around and bees buzzing around my head, and I got this incredible rush of energy. Through the years, I've taken many people on tours of organic farms, and if you haven't done that yet with your life, I urge you to put that on your list, because I've never seen someone not change when they step on an organic field. And then I remember the first farmer I met was Ernie Fordos, and he was growing all these kidney beans, and I looked down this row of kidney beans, and the first thing I thought to ask him was, well, Ernie, how do you deal with weeds? And in the inimitable farmer response, which is farmers use little words to say lots, he said, grandkids. And I said, grandkids? How many grandkids do you have? As I was looking out on 50 acres. He said, three. And I said, Ernie, how do three grandkids plow these fields and hold these fields? And he got this self-satisfied grin on his face. And he said, you know, Bena, when you work with nature and not against her, there are weeds. There's plenty of soil for the weeds, but there's also soil for the beans. So weeds aren't any big deal. Well, that kind of changed my life. And I decided not to go back to the University of Michigan that fall and go to business school, but instead stay working for this fledgling natural food company so that I could tell the world about the farmers who are the stewards of the soil and about the earth. And I did that. In fact, we sold a lot of Ernie's beans. We sold a lot of other people's beans in the 10 years that I worked for Eden Foods. And we sold a lot of other products too. And I was lucky because I got to learn from them every year and I got to retell what they told me to our consuming public. And 10 years later, I found myself working for an organic corn tortilla chip company, of all things. And then I learned about sustainable consumption. Because when you take an organic commodity like corn and you add salt and oil and turn it into a crunchy snack food, guess what? Most people who eat a bag of chips say, that was good. Can I have another one? And that's when I learned about volume. And I really thought that I was healing the earth because I was creating more room for more acreage to be converted from conventional farming to organic farming. At our company, it was Little Bear Organic Foods. We sold white chips and yellow chips. And then we introduced the consuming public to blue corn chips. And this was back in the early 90s. Blue corn was kind of a weird anomaly. If you went to a really hip Super Bowl party, you might have gotten blue corn chips. And everyone talked about how cool they were. But blue corn is actually an ancient form of corn. It's non-hybrid. So it has more trace minerals and twice the iron of white corn and yellow corn. And so things were good. Sales were growing. And then we began having a problem with our blue corn. And the problem was, when we first harvested the grain, it was really this brilliant royal blue color. But as we stored the grain in grain bins, because we prided ourselves on making fresh masa chips where you grind the grain as part of the production, the chips started fading and becoming lighter and lighter and lighter. And by the end of the crop year, instead of selling really blue chips, we were selling gray chips, which it was hard enough to sell blue food, but selling gray food was almost impossible. So we tried all these things at the point of production to fix the problem, and nothing worked. So on the inspection trip that year, by this time there was organic certification. You had to hire third-party inspectors. I went on the trip to the farmer, and I asked the farmer, is there not something you can do in the field that will help the corn keep its color? Well, it was Farmer Jim, and he got this glint in his eye and got all lit up and said, I can fix the problem for you. I know exactly what to do. So I checked that problem off my list and went to the next one. Well, what Jim decided to do was plant 200 acres of cotton in his crop rotation the season before blue corn. Now, all of you know that organic farmers, part of the tenets of organic farming is you don't grow the same crop on the same field every year. Working with nature means you grow different crops on different fields. So Jim had this theory, and his theory was that the cotton crop would fix certain nutrients and thereby make the corn crop better. All I knew was Jim was going to fix our problem. So that spring, he called me up and said, my cotton's growing. And I said, great, Jim, maybe we'll have a better corn crop next year. And then a few months later, he called me and said, you know, I'm going to get a yield out of this cotton. And I said, congratulations. And he said, well, you're going to sell it for me, right? Because you sell everything I grow. And I said, Jim, I sell food. And he said, but Bene, it's organic. And I said, but Jim, you still can't eat it. And then we started researching cotton, and we found out what hopefully many of you know, which is it's the second most pesticide-laden crop in the world. It uses, if you take all the world's cultivated land, cotton's grown on like 3 or 4 or 5% of that land, but it uses 10% of the Earth's pesticides every year and 25% of the Earth's insecticides every year. So it was like suddenly we had this marketing story in front of us. Nobody was doing this. We have to get Jim's cotton. We have to convince all these other organic farmers to grow cotton. This is a story. So we bought all of Jim's cotton. In fact, we bought it before he harvested it in case he decided to sell it to somebody else. We didn't want to lose it. And we had no idea, mind you, of what we were going to make out of this cotton or of how you take raw fiber from the field and turn it into finished apparel products. So we did a quick study, and we ended up making socks. And we made socks basically because they were small, and we could merchandise them in natural food stores and natural food co-ops, and those were the only people we knew. And then we quickly added T-shirts to our line. Once we learned the Great American T-shirt, you know, it's an advertisement, right? It's a disposable commodity, and it uses half a pound of cotton about for every T-shirt, and it also utilizes a third of a pound of chemicals just to grow the cotton for that one T-shirt. And so we got T-shirt sales became one of our, T-shirts quickly became our best-selling product. We got Ben and Jerry's to convert all of their T-shirts to organic. We started selling to musicians and rock bands and special event planning. And all of our contracts were in the U.S. In fact, we made all of our product in the southeastern United States. And then we started running into two problems that almost every apparel company in the world, I find out, has the same problems. And those two problems are late orders and poor quality. So the U.S. apparel industry was already under duress. I mean, people were moving contracts offshore. And we were making a basic T-shirt, the most basic article of clothing you could sell. So, and we were doing it at plants that were designed to make basic T-shirts. So these things didn't add up. I couldn't understand why, if these companies were under duress and they weren't operating at full capacity, why could I not get an order on time? So I started spending more time in the plants, the sewing facilities. And that's when I learned the dirty little secret about who sews the clothes we all wear. If you walk into a typical apparel factory, if you see men at all, they're the owners, or they run the heavy equipment that cuts the fabric. The rest of the employees are women. And they're not just women. They're undereducated women or completely uneducated women. They're oftentimes single heads of households, and they get paid by the piece. So if they're a sleeve setter, they learn how to craft sleeves and do sleeves as fast as they can. Their production manager sets a production goal and maybe decides you're supposed to sew 400 sleeves in a day. And if they sew 400 first quality sleeves in a day, they get minimum wage. And for every sleeve they sew over that in a day that's good quality, they get a nickel or a dime or 15 cents. So suddenly what happened to me was I realized why we couldn't get quality orders on time and why we couldn't get good quality craftsmanship. Basically, the women who sew our clothes are completely disenfranchised, not only from us, their customer, and from you, their consumer, but from even the finished product that they're sewing. All they care about is their little operation. So that was when I developed a kind of sick feeling in the pit of my stomach, and I started to question, how can we call ourselves a sustainable enterprise when we can't even sustain the lives of the people who actually make our clothing? And I knew we had to do something about it, but I was lost. Well, then this special week happened, and it sort of changed the path of me and my company, and it changed my whole feeling about sustainability. And that happened over one T-shirt order for a special concert. Ben & Jerry's had just launched the ice cream flavor called Fish Food. Have all of you eaten fish food? You know what fish food is. It's delicious, right? So the band Fish was getting a national reputation, and they decided they were going to do a concert to clean up Lake Champlain, where they're from. Great. So we got the contract, and Ben & Jerry's decided what a great way to do a commemorative T-shirt for the concert and also promote the ice cream flavor. So, of course, we got the contract, and There was one day in my office that I got two calls within kind of rapid succession of one another. The first call was from the Ben & Jerry's ice cream scoop shop manager in Burlington, Vermont, who very excitedly told me that the tickets were selling like crazy, the ice cream was going nuts, and where were his t-shirts? The next call I got was from Neil. Neil was the guy who owned the plant in Scottsboro, Alabama, that had the sewing contract for us for these t-shirts. And Neil basically told me in a slow southern drawl that, you know them blue shirts that we got to do for that order? And I said, yeah, that's a fish order. What about them? And he said, well, you know, we're not going to make that deadline. We're just, stuff has happened and we're late and we're not. And I said, no, Neil, these t-shirts are for a concert. Like, I can't tell the band to keep jamming until the tees get there. The tees have to be there before the concert starts. And we have to do anything we can do to get this order out in time. And he just kept saying, no, I've already done the math. And now that the sleeve hemmer's fixed, well, you know, we have to sew 1,200 shirts a day starting today, work a half a day Saturday, it's not going to happen. You know, we've never sewn more than 1,000 shirts in a day. So I hung up the phone with Neil, and I did what any kind of rational, semi-rational person who didn't have a third floor window to jump out of would have done in my position. And that is, I got in my car, drove to Metro Airport, flew to Memphis, Tennessee, rented a car, drove 3.5 hours to Neil's plant in Scottsboro, Alabama, and I jumped into the production line. I just started doing anything I could do to speed up this process. I started flipping sleeves inside out and trimming threads and delivering thread to people who ran out of thread, and I just was, you know, come on, let's go. And the women didn't really embrace me. In fact, they didn't really acknowledge me, but I was, after all, helping them make more money to feed their families, so they didn't ask me to leave either. But Neil talked to me right away. And what Neil told me is, you're disrupting my facility, get out of here, we'll get the order done, we get the order done, you're not welcome in my plant, leave. And I wouldn't leave, I just listened to him and kept going and kept going. So that night I got a hotel room, came back the next morning, and now Neil was agitated. He was like really angry, and he started threatening me. He started saying things like, you know, if you don't leave, I'm going to take your shirts off the line, we're never going to finish your order, we're just going to put somebody else's order, and you're never going to get those shirts. And I kept saying the same thing, you know, Neil, if you could just let me talk to these women and tell them how important this order is for me and what a big account Ben and Jerry's is. And he was like, no, these are my women, you can't talk to them, you're disrupting us, leave. And finally I said to him, you know, if you want to call the police and get me escorted out of the building, that's your prerogative, but short of that, I'm staying here and I'm not leaving without my shirts. Well, so then finally the bell rang. That was another thing. They had bells in sewing facilities all the time. It was like the imported school bells to let people know when it was break time and lunchtime and end of shift. It was really demoralizing. So the bell rang, and Neil came up to me and said, you got 10 minutes. So I assumed that meant I had 10 minutes to talk to these women, and that's what I started doing. I gathered as many of them around who was listening, and I started talking to them about, these aren't just t-shirts, these are organic cotton t-shirts, and we use organic cotton because it stains the earth, and blah, 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 and nothing, no reaction. And then I started talking about that this was a special order for this band called Fish. Then I got really blank stares, you know, band called Fish, no, it didn't add up. And I said, you know, they're talented musicians, and they met at the University of Vermont, and they live in Burlington, and Burlington has this lake in it called Lake Champlain, and the lake and the town are like totally intertwined, and everybody relies on the lake for their livelihood and their pleasure. And well, if you lived in Burlington, you know, your kids would swim in the lake, and you would get fish out of the lake and eat it for dinner, and blah, blah, blah. And I said, you know, I already know we can't finish this order complete. I already know that you can't sew more than 1,000 shirts a day. But I'm going to be here, and I'm going to help you, and we're going to work through this, and I really need you to stay as long as you can and get as many of these shirts done as you can, blah, blah, blah. Well, the women didn't sew 1,200 shirts that day. The women sewed 1,450 shirts that day. They sewed 1,424 shirts the next day. We loaded the last box on Friday afternoon, not Saturday. The order was complete and perfect, and we all hooped and hollered when we got the last box on the truck. And the most amazing part for me, and the part that really changed my direction in my company, was that I would watch these women, two thimbles on each hand, phone under their ear, and they'd be saying things like, well, you're just going to have to make a peanut butter sandwich for dinner. I can't come home. I have a lake to save. They didn't say, my boss is making me work overtime. They didn't say, this crazy northern woman is telling me about soil and fish. They said, I have a lake to save. And it was then that I really realized there was no such thing as environmental sustainability without social responsibility. Now, I'd like to say the story ended happily right there, but of course it didn't. We then started losing contractors to bankruptcy. We actually lost 6 U.S. contractors in a period of 18 months before Earth Day 2000. So our business was starting to be taken down by this lack of commitment and this loss by these contractors. And that's when I said to my production manager, you know, we have to go offshore with our sewing. We can make our socks in the U.S. We still make our socks in the U.S. It's 20 years later. But we can't keep going like this with apparel. We're going to lose our company. So our production manager ended up at this organics meeting in Nebraska, of all places, and he ran into this guy that he knew, Mike Woodard. And Mike Woodard was from an NGO. You all know what an NGO is? I didn't at the time. It's a non-government organization whose mission is to basically do good in the world. And this NGO called Jubilee House had lived in Nicaragua for 8 years and had been doing work with poor people in Nicaragua. Actually, Nicaragua is the second poorest country in the hemisphere, and their unemployment rate in the community they worked in is like 80%. And so Peter asked Mike, well, what are you doing these days? And Mike said, well, you know, right now I'm working with organic farmers to export organic food into this country, and I just got 15,000 new refugees of Hurricane Mitch that were moved into our community with nothing. They've lost everything. And they keep telling me they don't want charity. They want employment, that they're still capable, able beings, and they want to support themselves and sustain themselves. And so Peter said, well, Bena has said we have to go offshore with our sewing. Do I even know how to sew? And Mike said, well, there's a sweatshop industry here in Nicaragua, so probably let me find out. And then I started dealing with this group in this community, and what I told them is, you know, if you can build a sewing facility where every worker has a vested interest in her success, where every worker has a reason to sew on time and good quality, we'll give you every sewing contract we have left anywhere. So what we did, after some amount of meeting with the government and trying to get grants and loans and buying equipment, is we developed this three-legged stool business model. And the three-legged stool is the workers are one leg. They're the workers who need the jobs and want employment. The second leg is the NGO. The NGO's mission is to basically help people improve their lives. And the third leg is us. We're the business, so we have the market. So we bring the market to this concept. And what Mike said to me is, what if we build a worker-owned cooperative? And I didn't know anything about cooperatives. The only thing I knew about cooperatives was the food co-op up the street that I volunteered at. And so I said, well, that sounds good. That sounds democratic. Let's try that. So we started this worker-owned cooperative with this three-legged business model, and we now have created a total of 4 cooperatives in Nicaragua and 1 in the United States. They're all worker-owned, one worker, one vote. They all have their own investment schedule. They work for us as well as for other companies, so we are not their only customers, and they've become independent. In fact, the first sewing cooperative we started in Nicaragua, in Nueva Vida, we don't even buy from them for the past 3 years. They've kind of developed their own chain, and it's not the same thing we're doing now, but they've improved their lives, and they've become the first worker-owned free trade zone in the world. So, and the fourth co-op we developed was a worker-owned co-op right in North Carolina, which is where all of our socks are made, because I think this business model has enough, it's feasible enough to apply it to other countries, other continents, as well as other businesses. And they're making a line of stuffed animals out of our socks. So they take our slightly irregular socks and they stuff them and they design these chickens and penguins and all sorts of things. So I guess what I want to leave you with from my perspective is that what I've learned about sustainability, I learned in concentric circles. Only I started with the biggest circle. I learned about soil and the earth and the planet. And then it kept coming down to a more and more personal level for me. And I really discovered that it's more about the relationships between each of us, like we've all talked about today, and the relationship we have to ourselves. So thanks for listening. Great day.